Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the RWBY Radio Show. I am your host, Kyle Moran, and today, ladies and gentlemen, we have with us Lightning in My Hand joining us. Lightning, welcome to the show.
Hello, good to be here.
Well, I'm glad to have you on board. Now, I want to ask you a few questions, considering that you are a YouTuber and a RWBY watcher, to say the least. What got you started or interested in the show RWBY?
Well, that was way back in 2013. I was on a binge of Rooster Teeth content. That was back when all the rage quit videos and stuff.
Fuck me in my fucking ass. You're going backwards! What are you doing? What? No Armstrong? Where the hell is he?
That's what got me into Rooster Teeth. So I started with Rage Quit, I got into a bunch of Rooster Teeth content, their shorts, and then I found the Red trailer, and that's what got me into RWBY.
Oh, okay. So you were on YouTube at the time, and you just happened to, something came in your feed, like, hey, check this out, it's a nice little animation, stuff like that.
I know, I actually saw it on the YouTube channel, because, like, the first Rooster Teeth thing I found was Rage Quit Slender, because that was when Slender was big, and I wanted to know what it was all about. So I found the Rage Quit Slender. I thought, hey, these guys are pretty funny. So I got on the Rooster Teeth binge from there. And then I found RWBY too on their channel.
Well, for me to tell my story of how I discovered RWBY, I knew Rooster Teeth for Rage Quit. I knew it for its famous show of Red versus Blue.
You can't pick up chicks in a tank.
Oh, you know what? You could bitch about anything, couldn't you? We're gonna get a tank, and you're worried about chicks.
But nothing really much else. I never knew the crew of Miles, Carey, Gray, Barbara, and all the other cast members until I was on Netflix one day and I was just perusing through shows to watch, and I came across this colorful little key card and it spelled RWBY. It was in the animation section, and I'm kind of a newbie when it comes to anime, and at first I turned it down, believe it or not. But then I came back, I boomeranged, and I was like, it lingered in my mind what this show was. And I gave it a try. It was during when Volume 1 and 2 were on Netflix, and it was in like the full hour-long season, so there was like no breaks and everything, so it was really cool.
Nice. I didn't actually know that for now RWBY was on Netflix. I thought it was just Crunchyroll and what was it? What's their new thing now? Verve?
I think, yeah, Verve, I'm pretty sure. Well, yeah, they're making leaps and strides. They're already coming out with, like, manga and stuff like that. I'm like, I like your show, but I'm not buying anything from it.
How many mangas do they have right now? They're like, I think they have another manga besides the one that they've been putting out that are, they have different artists for different reinterpretations of the RWBY story, apparently.
Whatever the story is, that's going to be another topic later in the interview and stuff like that. But yeah, I think they have like, I don't really have more than three, but less than seven.
Three? More than three?
I'm pretty sure, because I remember them doing a Blake one. I remember them promoting that a lot. And then I think there was one on Weiss, but I don't know the others. But I know it's more than three. Or else they've just been promoting like one or two books the entire time.
Oh, do you mean like chapters? Because I was thinking like different artists for different manga artists who are putting out like separate chapters. It's like I remember just one, which was like the manga version of the four trailers. Weiss's had like an extra at the end where it had like a super grim armor that she had to fight.
And I have no fucking clue. Like I said, I don't follow them that deep and stuff like that. So, I'm just basically surface level stuff. But moving on into the interview, what do you do in the RWBY community? What is your role? What is your position?
I'm not really sure anymore. 2014 and 15, I was pretty big on DeviantArt. I was like doing a bunch of fan art and those four coma comics when they were big on DeviantArt. Basically just a bunch of doing like a comic series crossovering the introduction of the four RWBY characters with like Team Fortress trailers, Team Fortress 2 trailers, and they're like really badly done because I wasn't good at drawing back then. But I think I just one, my, actually my biggest contribution to the RWBY community might be the RWBY font that everyone keeps using. I made that in like February of 2014 from, I basically picked a bunch of letters that other people have made for their own RWBY OC posters, and I mashed them together with current canon 4 RWBY letters, RWBY, and basically made a font out of that.
Hmm. So you were originally an artist, a drawer.
Yeah.
And you said you created a font?
Yeah, the RWBY font. It's still one of the first search results if you Google RWBY font.
Oh. Well, that's amazing. I'm glad you made such an impact. The only impact I really have on the RWBY community is that if you search up, yeah, I destroy thoughts, you'll get a... you get a RWBY image of her doing like the karate chop in season 1 with like red glowing eyes and those who respect women as the title thing. It was a remix of what someone other did for Yeah, I Destroy Thoughts, but except it was a businessman, but I did it with RWBY. So that's my accomplishment.
Hey, meat's a commodity in the RWBY community.
Hey, the amino is another story. I don't even want to talk about it. You go watch Flu Studio. In fact, here's a plug. Check out my previous RWBY radio show with the Floof artist. It's currently up on his channel. It's currently up on mine. Mine has very little views. Don't go watch mine. Go watch his, because that means he gets better and then he could possibly have more interviews with me. Woo! We all win. Moving on with the interview. If there was something you could change about the show, anything at all, what would it be?
Oh boy. Oh boy.
Where to start?
Yeah, the biggest thing would be RWBY as a main character, because everyone who's listening to this might probably already have heard that, or have heard the opinion that John has taken over RWBY as the main character. So the one thing I would change, and this would go back all the way to volume 1, is just not have John there, or not focus the second half of volume 1 on anything remotely Juniper, and take John's I have no semblance, I am unskilled with all this semblance and aura stuff.
He hasn't found his semblance yet, but we all know he will, and you will too. We all just have to try and help each other get stronger.
All that aspect of him, and put that to RWBY, like make her just this teenage girl who's good with a scythe because she's trained so hard at it. Because she's not good at anything else. She's not good at aura and semblance and stuff, and that's why she's so good with a scythe, because she spent all her time doing that. Basically like Rock Lee from Naruto. That's the only Naruto thing I know, is that Rock Lee is really good at fighting because he has no aptitude for anything else. Make RWBY be like that. Make RWBY an endearing underdog character that they made John in the canon. Give that underdog role to RWBY. Make me want to root for her.
I was pretty disappointed with the whole transition from in the earlier volumes centering on RWBY to mostly another character. They do try to spice it up and give other characters like screen time and stuff like that, and that's fine. The title of the show is 4 characters, RWBY being the quote-unquote main character. But I do have to agree with you that Jean is getting more screen time in Volume 5. I would agree with you there. But recently in Volume 6, I feel like...
They just like kicked Jean out of the show.
No, he's still there. He's still in the background, lurking. But no, I've seen in Volume 6 just so much amount of Blake and Yang in scenes together. They're doing it almost intentionally, which, you know, I don't blame them. It's their show. They can do what they want.
Yeah, because like also because it's probably really easy to put Blake and Yang together and have them interact. Ever since that scene from Volume 2 where Yang opened up to Blake about her past, and they've established that personal connection.
But first you have to sit down and listen to what I have to say. RWBY and I grew up in Patch, an island just off the coast of Vale. And my dad just kind of shut down. It wasn't long before I learned why.
It's just been Blake and Yang. I don't think Blake and RWBY have shared like one line of dialogue together in Volume 6. At the end of Volume 5 there was one, but Blake, the very first other member of RWBY that you think of when you hear Blake is Yang and not like Weiss or RWBY herself.
There was a scene. I recently was watching Volume 6 to catch up on this interview. When they enter into the old abandoned house, RWBY's looking at the photos and there's like a little quip from Blake.
What do you think?
Something doesn't feel right.
Which I wish there was more of. I really wish there was more of. I just wish there was more combinations of characters talking to each other, except for the ships. And stuff like that. Like, I wish Weiss and Blake would talk more. I wish RWBY and Yang would get along as sisters. You don't think they're sisters because they don't talk to each other.
Yeah, and like, the last time they were seen on screen, like, being all real sisterly and stuff was when, was that when, in the middle of Volume 5, when Yang was, like, playing with her hair and smacking RWBY's face with her hair while in the morning bringing them a bunch of coffee or something? Or was she doing that, like, to tease Weiss? I can't even remember half of Volume 5 anymore.
Yeah, it's a blur between red couches and nothing.
And beige overlays on everyone.
Beige overlays, and there was something about ramen, but that's a fever dream for another day. Moving on, you probably have already semi-answered this, but who is your favorite character in the show?
Main character or overall, like real overall?
Favorite character. Who do you like the most, for whatever reason?
There's not really one favorite character, because like they're all being split up by criteria, like between personality and fighting style and design and all that stuff.
Okay, we'll rattle off a few if you have multiple.
Okay, so really the one person that comes to mind is Sun, because like he's just a real confident dude and he's got a really awesome fighting style when they put effort into his action scenes. And mostly I'm biased towards him because I just love Michael Jones. And design-wise, just visually, I would say it's Roman. Because like, he's just so suave and dapper.
He's like a Jack Sparrow-looking motherfucker.
Yep.
That's got to be the best pirate I've ever seen.
So it would seem.
I'm super sad that he was killed off in Volume 3. I mean, was it a good death? Maybe. But to kill Gray and his acting and his performance in the show, it was just pitiful. But yeah, he's a great character. I love him. If I were to name off a few of my favorite characters, or just my top one is Blake, for a couple reasons. One, I think she has, believe it or not, the most distinct personality of the group. Or at least I used to think that. Recently in Volume 6, there has been several character changes since it's been a darker mood. But in the earlier volumes, everyone had like the same upbeat, high-pitched voice, you know, super happy, go-lucky persona. But Blake Belladonna had this reserved, niche appearance in this world, which made her stand out, which made a lot of people like her. Another reason is because she's Faunus. Faunus are awesome. And there was some other thing. I think she has the best backstory, to be honest, regarding the lore of the backstory and stuff like that and yada, yada, yada. She just seems like
the first one with actual backstory. She was the first one to, like, we don't get to see Weiss's family before we get to know about Blake and her history with the White Fang.
Right, right. You know, other characters had, you know, Yang had her backstory with her protecting RWBY with the Grimm and stuff like that. There's other backstory. Well, Weiss really doesn't have a backstory, just like shitty family, that's my backstory.
yeah, shitty family, I have to be the poster child, but I want to rebel and be my own person.
Other main characters that I really like, for the villain side, I love Emerald. Again, it's her personality and her backstory which is the most compelling. Compared to the other villains, Tyrion is a psychopath. Woohoo, yay, that's awesome. But Tyrion was given no backstory. Why is he a psychopath? I don't know. He's just crazy. So that ruins him. Again, these characters aren't given enough depth sometimes to be attached to, which I'm shocked about Neo, because Neo doesn't have anything going for her besides being mute, but everyone loves her, you know?
She's basically fan service at this point. Nothing would have changed if she just stayed, like, dead somewhere or ran away after she realized that Roman is dead.
And there was a Murder of Bird Twitter post. It's like, are you all really surprised that Neo is back? Or is it like, do you think Neo is overrated? And everyone's like, no.
Yeah, I didn't care for Neo coming back, but I'm totally not surprised that she is back, because, like, almost every other RTX panel with RWBY I've seen, there's at least one person looking for Neo or asking about Neo or asking, like, is it confirmed that Neo's coming back, or if Neo comes back, would she have a new outfit? They just keep asking for it. Now she's back. Easy fan service.
Yeah, that's what they do. I'm fucking pissed that Cinder is still alive. Fucking stupid. I hate that shit. Why? Like, what did they have going?
I don't know. Cinder's just a one-track person at this point. He might have had something in Volume 4, but then that all just got wiped away when she started being all sassy and just a bad impersonation of Lust from Fullmetal Alchemist.
Such a sad and weak creature. Another typical human.
Anime comparison time.
Your little Miss Malachite. Learn to kill them.
You'll know what you need when you need to know it.
Why are you smiling?
When she left Salem's castle and started being her old self again.
I just thought at the end of Volume 5, it was like poetic justice, you know? It was a perfect way for her to go out. There was, you know, she fell. That was in her last name. It was just the perfect way to go out. Kind of like, press F in the chat for Pyranikos with the shot through the knee, through the heart, stuff like that. It was just the best way to go out. And then they bring her back and it's like,
she...
I don't think they ever intended to keep her dead and decided to bring her back at the last minute. I mean, there was no body. It's always a thing with these. If there's no body, then
I know
she could come back.
But that's a cop out. That's a complete cop out. If you're in, first of all, the area around them is like a cavern, and even if there is water at the bottom of that ravine or wherever she fell, hitting water is like hitting concrete. Worse than concrete.
Aura, man. Oh wait, she had no aura when she fell down. She shouldn't be alive.
This is disappointing, and my day is ruined.
My disappointment is immeasurable, and my day is ruined.
Who is the worst character of the show, do you think?
Oh boy. The very obvious answer is John, but I'm gonna admit that John's not exactly a bad character. He's just a character with too much screen time that could have been given to RWBY. I'm gonna say Cinder.
Hmm. Why do you think that?
It's because she's just there, and she keeps almost dying. Like, we thought she died with the silver eyes, and in Volume 3, she's back. Suddenly, mm-hmm. She's back. And we thought she died in Volume 5, she's back. And nothing changes for her. We don't know anything about her backstory or why she works for Salem. We don't know why she wants all that power. We just know that she wants power. And now we just know that she wants to kill RWBY. She didn't learn anything. She's just so flat. She's been the flattest villain I've ever seen in like five, six years of RWBY. Like, I would honestly have preferred like Hazel or Watts be the new main character, or even Emerald. Like, have her go crazy and swear revenge on RWBY for killing her surrogate mother or something, and then Salem using her as a puppet and like infusing her with Grimm, and having Emerald be the new big bad of the series just because she wants revenge for Cinder. But no, it's Cinder all over again.
Yeah, I know. That just, she doesn't die. She's like a fire ant. You can't kill her.
She's a copper. You set off an atomic bomb, she just comes back.
But the worst character for me in my mind, and I held this character in my mind for a long time, I thought the worst character was... I thought Penny was the worst character. I thought Penny in the earlier volumes was the worst character. Because there was nothing to her besides, I'm a robot. There was nothing else. She had no... I mean, her weapons were cool and stuff like that, but she didn't have anything going for her. There was nothing going for her. I know I'm repeating myself, but I want to emphasize that point. I held that opinion. I'm sorry.
Until you said Penny, I actually forgot that Penny existed until just now.
I know. There's so many fucking characters. It's like a Roman doll. You keep pulling open one top, and then another one comes right out the bottom, and there's no end to it.
A Matryoshka doll.
Yeah, a Matryoshka doll. It's like, are you the last one? Nope, shit, there's one more spell than you. I held that opinion for the longest time, but in recent volumes, volume 6, chapter 3, it immediately changed to Salem. After volume 6, chapter 3, which we'll talk later in the interview, has become the worst character in the show, and it's because of her motivation and her desire.
Her entire backstory being essentially what was a crack ship during the era of Volume 3 becoming canon now.
No, not even that. I'll explain it to you. I'll explain to you my position later, and you can tell yours. But to me, she is the worst character now, and that's all I'm gonna say until we get to that that part, and I'll tell you later. But moving on to the next question, you have a very popular YouTube channel with around 2,000 subscribers to your channel. Can you describe what you do on your YouTube channel and what type of content you make?
Well, basically, I make shit posts.
What is it?
Shit, man, I wouldn't think so.
Basically, I try to criticize RWBY, present options and how it could have been done better, or just point out what's wrong with it. But I always have the philosophy of, while you're doing that, make people laugh. Nobody wants to hear a rant without a joke at the end or in between it. Also, I'm not really a theme channel. I know it seems like I'm a RWBY theme channel, but I'm not. I have a bunch of... I post JoJo. I sometimes make like AMVs. I'm actually planning on doing like a bunch of New Albion stuff. If you haven't heard of New Albion, it's a bunch of web opera musicals. And I'm thinking of like doing some lyric videos in the style of my old fan-made World of Remnant animations, if you can call them animations. They're just paper cutouts. They're sliding across the screen. But
hey, any type of animation is animation.
Yeah, well, that's what I've got like planned in the future. I don't know how much of it I'm gonna be doing.
Well, I always am a fan of the opera, so I'll see how that goes. But moving on into the interview, currently, I believe volume 6, chapter 6 has come out yet? I don't know. I'm not a first member, so I don't have the privilege of watching a new episode and paying, what is it, like $10 a month?
Yeah, it has. It has like 14 hours ago, midnight where I am, but I was asleep at the time.
But currently, we are like mid-season of volume 6, and do you think so far it is good or bad? And tell me why.
Okay, it's kind of in the middle, because volume 5, it had a good concept, but the execution was where it fell flat. This time, the execution is fine, the fight scenes are good, the exposition actually shows instead of just tells, but the lore, especially volume 6 episode 3, the lore just got so jumping the shark-ish. It reminded me almost of Darling in the Franxx, where suddenly we're throwing gods into the mix and they're an active part in the endgame of RWBY now, because apparently the relics summon the gods if they're all brought together, like Dragon Balls. Because before this volume came out, all we knew about the gods is that from Crow said in Volume 4 that they made the relics and then they left Remnant. So they're an origin, but not an active part in the plot. And Salem is the reason for Ospin's immortality. But now it turns out that Ospin lied and that his immortality is linked to bringing the gods back to Remnant to judge all of humanity, which that opens up a whole can of worms. Like, I made an entire rant video about that, about what standards the gods have for judging humanity, or what is the minimum bad that humanity has that would make the gods destroy Remnant, because they were pretty clear about this. The God of Light was pretty clear about this, that if humanity was still bad when they came back to Remnant, it's game over, there's no more planet, your world would be destroyed, is what he said. Yeah, Volume 6 really messed up like the end game and the whole entire plot for me, and it just kind of pushed Salem to the side. Like, I don't care about Salem anymore. I care about, like, what the gods are gonna do, or if they, what are they gonna do about making humanity fit enough for the gods.
Yeah. Watching Volume 6, I got the impression that the story was revised to be better. There was going to be more fight scenes, and there are, and it's good in that aspect. But overall in Volume 6, I feel like there is a lack of brain cells. There are idiots everywhere, including in the main team. Just watching the episodes and having an open mind, you could just see holes throughout the entire show. One of my biggest gripes when the first episode was released is that they're on the train and the guy whips out the turrets to fight off the Brim. And everyone's on his shit because using the turrets attracts it to the passenger cars. And they're like, shut off the turrets or you're gonna kill everyone in the cars. If you take 3 seconds to think about it,
why do they have turrets on the cars where passengers would be?
That is one. Yes, that is one. That is one example. Another example is that they have turrets for this occasion. And another thing is that you're killing Grimm. They're not respawning. If you don't fight the Grimm, guess what? They're gonna hunt you. They're gonna eat you. They're gonna fight you. You're worrying out your mind. Off the Grimm that are chasing you, that means you feel confident, you feel great, you're winning the battle. Apparently not. You gotta shut off the turrets and derail the train. It's like Call of Duty, Trango Boom.
Anime comparison time.
Outcome: Trango Boom.
I'm gonna play the devil's advocate here and not say that they didn't bring into account this many Grimm, or even like the Alpha Sphinx Manticore thing coming to the train, because there's never been a Grimm magnet relic on the train before. They've just needed, like, the turrets were pretty effective when it came to smaller Grimm that usually pass the railways, and since that the bigger Grimm and their leader are on the train now because they're attracted to the relic, then that makes the turrets less effective, because like the leader Grimm is telling them to target the turrets, when all the other times in the past it would have just been like stragglers who didn't know what the turrets were and just wanted to eat the passengers. So maybe I'll give them that.
Yeah, if you think about it, it's just stupid. It's just
don't think about it. Turn off your brain.
Who's writing this show?
Yeah, no, I it's not that, like, obviously everybody's just trying to help, but the thing that drives me crazy is how people will speak with such a matter-of-fact, I know everything tone. Right. That's the thing that always drives me fucking crazy. There's like, because you'll get like, I learned to deal with this just on like video comments. People will make a comment, maybe it's like a criticism or something, and you go, okay, yeah, that's a fair critique, but you don't want to listen to them because of the way they said it. And sometimes people get in there and they'll talk exactly like they know how, like, the production process works. Like, oh, this is clearly why this was animated this way. It's like, motherfucker, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. But the reason I fucking hate you is because you talk like you do and other stupid people listen to you. That's my biggest fucking problem with it.
Oh, he is. And we all know who he is. He who shall not be named. But
school is really bad with a lot of memory-related things.
I'm not good at a lot of memory-related things. It's really, really bad.
Yes, yes. We all have memory-related issues. It's just, we have amnesia. We have amnesia. But it gets worse. The volume gets worse. And moving into the next question. Volume 6, Chapter 3. Your thoughts.
It was better than A World of Remnant, at least. Yeah, it was basically a glorified, actually fully animated version of the exposition story in the campfire from Volume 4 with weed smoke transitions.
Damn, I miss Crow narrating.
We get it, you vape.
No. What were you going to say? Just continue what you were going to say.
The thing that really bothered me about that was the gods themselves. They're just petty bitches. Like, they apparently care and they're moved so much that one human worshipping at the foot of the god of darkness is enough for him to fulfill her request and bring Ozma back to life. Because, like, he feels so appreciative that he is worshiping at his feet. But then, just like, three armies worth of people rebelling against the gods makes them condone exterminating every single human on the planet. And then God of Light just says, fair an experiment. They're basically like, they're ants inside an ant farm. And one of the ants bit them. And now they're flooding the ant farm with lead or something. Like, make up your mind. Are you Greek gods or are you like Judeo-Christian gods that feel nice and give blessings when you're being worshipped? Are you Old Testament gods or are you New Testament gods? Come on, decide, please.
I like the dualism aspect of the creation story. I love the, you know, dark side, light side, creating, destroying. I am a big fan of dualism, though I don't believe in it. I'm a big fan of it, don't believe in it. I never thought that was really a problem. The main problem stems from Salem. The whole entire episode, I believe it, is dedicated to her, obviously, and her backstory. But her backstory just doesn't hold anything, and it bothers me. Salem wants her motive, her reason for doing what she does is for freedom. That's what Jin was talking about. Even at the end of the episode, it's like, I did this. We are free now.
We finally have freedom.
Hi. Freedom this, freedom that. Okay, freedom from what? Freedom from being captive in a castle? I mean, I was getting the Rapunzel vibes going into it.
We never really knew why she was in the castle. She wasn't anything different from every other human who could use magic. Like, she wasn't like a secretly half monster or something. She wasn't like Fiona from Shrek where she turned into an ogre at night. She was just a human who had a dick of a father who put her in a castle.
It's just the motivation for everything. It's just so bad. Like, she wants freedom. Okay, she gets it in the end. And even when she obliterates Ozpin, or Oz, whatever his name was, it's unsatisfying. And even when, and this is the worst part, I think, of the dichotomy of the show, is that when she is pleading for the gods to bring back her dead husband, or bring back Ozpin, I'm just going to call him Ozpin for the sake. The gods are trying to teach her a lesson. Maybe this is just part of her character, but she ignores it. She ignores it, like, full on. Like, the God of Light gives this grandiose speech about the importance of life and death, and she's just like, nope.
Life and death are part of a delicate balance.
No.
She's a thought!
I'm like, you thought.
Be gone, thought!
You hoe. Ah, it's just, that's probably a good thing. Probably what you're supposed to feel as a as a viewer, as an audience, it just doesn't sit well.
It's like basically an entitled bitch who can't let go of someone that passed away.
Right. She's a thought. She's a hoe. She can't let go of things. She can't learn. She can't move past. And I was getting vibes of Shadow of the Colossus. Is this if you haven't played Shadow of the Colossus, the entire crux of the game is you want to bring your dead girlfriend back to life, and you have to kill all these creatures. Salem is kind of doing the same thing, just with the roles are reversed, and we have a thought instead of an actual good main character. But again, if you go back to her main theme of freedom, it has nothing to do with why she wants to bring him back. Yes, she loved him, and that's important. But she throws
some arbitrary reason about how Ozma made her feel free or something that Jin said, but we never got to see.
Again, freedom is loosely defined in the show, whatever the fuck freedom means. But just the entire episode was just hitting myself over the head. Like, seriously, this is the main villain of the show. The main villain, which we're supposed to hate as an audience, or love, depending on which side you're voting for. I'm trying to put it into words. I truly am. Absence of motivation. The absence of drive. There was a quote said, "A hero is only as good as their villain." You have shit villains and shit heroes, believe it or not. You don't have really one or the other. You just have both terrible things. So I can't root for the villains to win because they're shitty, and I can't root for the heroes to win because they're brain dead. This is what fans were waiting for. This is what is the culmination of Monty's work, Miles' work, the animation team's work, and it just falls flat. This was my breaking point. You understand?
I get what you're trying to say. I just feel like Salem just lives on spite now. She doesn't want anything. She doesn't want to reestablish her kingdom. She just wants to spite Ozpin.
What is her goal?
For the gods that she hates. She wants to spite him because they're both immortal, and she doesn't want him to ever, like, how dare you betray me by working for the god that refused to bring you back to me? And basically that's what I'm getting her goal is. There's no higher goal. There's no other thing that she wants besides just being obsessed with Ozpin and throwing a hissy fit whenever she hears his name.
Yeah, that. Again, it's her motivation. Why does she do the things she does? You can't give a reason. It's like, oh, you want to smite Ozpin because you want world domination? I thought that was at the end of Volume 3 and the start of Volume 4 and a little bit of 5. We all thought it was like world domination. Cinder wants to rule the world. She wants to control everyone. She was a control freak, which she kind of is. Fucking normies! But we're never given any clue to that. We don't see like a map of like, oh, I want to take this city and then I want to take that one. We're not given any visual of her tactitional status, or, I mean, you could see her impotent rage, but that's about it. She's surface level, and it's just pitiful. And that was the breaking point for me of Volume 6, Chapter 3.
This is what happens when you put Darth Vader into the role of the Emperor. Especially just fresh out the Mustafar Darth Vader. Where is Ozpin? Is he alive?
I don't like snow. I could just see that. I just want to see like Oscar like staring out a window and it's like, I hate snow. It's like, I hate sand.
I don't like sand.
You know, you and Floof Artist both love prequels. Well, you, Floof Artist, and me all love prequels.
Yeah, the meme potential, man.
It's so good. I need to watch them over again, but I'll have to pirate them.
Really, here's the high quality ones, and you just take space.
Nice. Here's another question. since we're halfway through the volume, what are you looking forward to for this volume?
Oh, I have no more expectations for Ruby. I just hope that we can actually see Atlas and see anything outside of this new manor. Like, show me that. Show me what the pinnacle of technological advancement in the world of Remnant is like. Is it like New York? Is it like LA or something? Is it like Back to the Future 2? Is it everything chrome and everything slime? Is it Star Wars? Is it Coruscant?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it just going to be the inside of the again?
So would you like that like around episode 10 or 11?
Yeah, and at least like since they already ruined Hazel as a villain, that Watts is probably the one thing left, the one unruined villain in Salem's posse. Because I'm not counting Merc and Emerald as villains, they're just like kids or like employees, interns basically, and they're loyal to Cinder, but not to Salem. I want to see Watts, like, he's supposed to be like the, apparently according to Raven, a disgraced at least. See him, his motivation, like, what does he want from working with Salem? Does he want, like, Atlas to fall or, like, to humiliate and kill the people who disgraced him and kicked him out of Atlas or something? I want to see that.
Okay. That, I don't think you'll get it, but that's something to shoot for.
Yeah, like I said, I have no more expectations, so I don't care if I get it or not.
My expectations are set, though, but I would like to see sometime either at the end of this volume or sometime in the next one, a fight in the tundra or a fight on the snow, and utilizing the terrain like they did in the Vital Festival as combat opportunities, like using snowbanks as cover. Using Weiss's glyphs to fabricate like walls and stuff if they're fighting off against Grimm or the White Fang or baddies.
Like, yeah, if they include both Weiss or Winter and a maiden with like the ability to control the elements, there's a lot of creative stuff they could do with snow. Like, make all these weird friggin' combinations, or like make an entire What's that thing from Fate where he summons the billions of swords out of nowhere and just throws them at the opponent? I want to see that coming out of the maidens. Like, you've got something, you got a power to create anything out of any element, like ice or fire or wind or electricity. The limit is your imagination. You're not restricted by aura when you're a maiden. And all Cinder's done is make swords out of it. Make giant swords out of it. Like, that's what I want to see. Use the environment, use the elements, be creative. That's what I want to see.
Okay, not that bad. Moving on to getting near the end of this interview. Let's talk about the Rooster Teeth products. Now, I'm pretty sure the first Rooster Teeth game that they released is Grim Eclipse, which is a hack and slash Bayonetta Devil May Cry game. From what I've heard and what I saw, it looks unpolished. What are your views on it, if you know about it?
I haven't actually personally played the game, but it just seems, from what gameplay I've seen, it looks like pretty repetitive. And just, okay, it reminds me of Devil May Cry, but it reminds me, like, it's trying to be God of War, but it's not there yet. It just doesn't grab my innards. Even when it's on sale, I'm just like, do I really want to spend money on this? I don't want to. There's better stuff I could be spending my money on Steam. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'm glad you agree with me. You know, some people say, oh, it's a great game, you should definitely go buy it. But I'm like, no. There's other things worth your time. I'd rather purchase the Stanley Parable, which is a walking simulator, than this game. But another game that they kicked off very well, I say in quotations, was BlazBlue, with their introduction of their two characters and the controversy of the DLC character. From what
Japan was not prepared for how badly people in America take DLC, especially with characters that they really care about.
Well, I mean, I'd be pissed if, you know, I was expecting my team roster to appear on the game, but then is sold as DLC. I mean, imagine FIFA locking off half the characters of Real Madrid or Barcelona, or just literally half the characters of every team is locked behind DLC. Imagine EA doing that. Actually, that's a bad idea. EA, do not trademark that.
Doesn't EA already do that?
They do it with my team and stuff like that, but I don't play their shitty sports games because I'm not a sports fanatic.
I don't think that's all people are mad about. I think just like RWBY got the short end of the stick with just four RWBY characters and like a bunch of other extra characters for Undernight and Persona 4. Obviously, RazeBlue has the most because it's their name on the game, but like just four of the main RWBY characters. I mean, I get why they just chose to have the main four, because obviously it's RWBY, it's RWBY, you gotta have RWBY. And I get that it's hard to like do the math and tweak each new character's attacks, because every other character has already existed in a previous game. They've all had their movesets and their hitboxes all mapped out and calculated and tweaked as the game has gone on. But RWBY is new to the fighting game, the 2D fighter arena, basically. And I guess they didn't want to waste their time doing the math and playtesting a bunch of other RWBY characters, maybe because some people in the RWBY community might not agree with the people they chose to add in. No! Like, I'm pretty sure they would have added like a Crow or Adam in it, but it's just kind of rough. RWBY's gotten short end of the stick, basically.
I mean, the game looks fun to play. It probably is fun to play. It's a fighter like any other. It's just a shame that the bad news press was stained over Rooster Teeth and the game in general. Of course, Rooster Teeth didn't make the game, so there is that. So thank God they didn't make the game, or else they'd probably make it like Remy Clips. But then there is the game they made, Almighty Arena. Funny enough, not to be confused with Clash Royale. It's a ripoff with your favorite characters. It's not that. I haven't played it, but it doesn't look that bad. It's a ripoff, so know that going in. It's not an original idea. But your thoughts on it?
I don't think Rooster Teeth themselves actually made the game. Hang on, I'm Googling it right now. The developer of the game is NHN Entertainment, which is a South Korean game developer. And it was only published by Rooster Teeth, so it's not even Rooster Teeth that made the game in its entirety. They just put their characters in and gave their funding or something.
Right. Well, it's Rooster Teeth products. I'm pretty sure they didn't make Grimmy Clips. I mean, some independent guy made Grimmy Clips, and then they hired him to make it. So Rooster Teeth isn't making games; they're advertising in games. But getting on to the last question of the interview, this one is a personal one. Who is your favorite YouTuber? You can even name yourself.
Okay, my favorite by far is Noble, or as his YouTube name goes, Lost Paws.
What's cracker, guys? Welcome to another. I have a secret, everyone. I've been a NECA this entire time.
The weeb?
Like, yeah, he's just a funny, cringy...
The fag? So, oh my god.
Yeah, he's just like, so chill and stuff. Like, he never...
He's chill?
He's basically so chill. He never gets into like any bad press. Like, he never gets into the news for saying stream. And he's just a fun channel to watch when I'm like drawing and want to hear him talk in the background.
Probably because he's self-aware, and unlike Batman Falling and all the other YouTubers, he's the only one that realizes the position he's in and then just rolls with the punches. So I could see that. I'm not subscribed to him. I think it was just a little too hyperactive for me. But I can respect.
He's not like, I'm pretty sure he's not Murder of Birds level hyperactive.
Oh my god!
This fucking dude!
Really? You think Murder Birds is hyperactive?
Well, everyone makes like memes about his face, and he's a reaction channel.
That I understand, but I don't think he's hyperactive. I think he's very emotional.
Right, but like, pump up their reactions and personalities to the max.
Yeah, that is basically Murder of Birds, and that's why I do not like him. He literally cried. The man cried in Volume 3 when Penny died. He cried when a robot died.
Why are we still here? Just to suffer.
When Penny died.
This man. Whose man is this?
I don't know. The only time I've never cried to Ruby.
That was the fakest shit I have ever seen in my life. He was crying over a Penny. And the Rooster Teeth were like, oh my god, he loves our show so much. We made a video reacting to his reaction of our show.
Oh no.
And I'm like, what? I mean, congrats for the man for getting the attention of an animation studio. I mean, props to him. You know, give him a round of applause, a golf clap. But goddamn, was that the fakest shit I've ever seen.
I haven't seen that, and I don't plan to.
I'm constantly shitting on it. And he, believe it or not, he's the one that recommended people watching him at the time, which I was, to go to the RWBY Amino.
Hey guys, what's up? Murder of Birds here, and welcome. This is going to be a very special RWBY-based video for you guys, talking about an awesome, awesome, awesome app that I discovered a couple months back that I want to bring to you guys and talk about. RWBY is the heart of my...
All of this just works. It's a great place. You can hang out with people who love the show. Yeah, go to a totalitarian cesspit where you can't post what you want. You can't talk to another person because it's considered confrontational. Ugh.
Is Amino worse than Tumblr?
I think so at point. At least on Tumblr, you can post porn and you can get away with it.
Not
and people
recently.
Actually... Not recently.
Press
you
F for even, all the faps
you
that
have
lost.
To, you're walking on glass on the Amino. Trust me, it is not a place you want to be. I had a problem once on the Amino. They took down a post I made because it was not relevant to the show because it had Filthy Frank in it. But it was a piece of paper that Gira was holding in Volume 4, 5. Yeah, when he was delivering his speech, instead of like looking at the parchment with all the scribble words, it's just Filthy Frank like doing the with the gun underneath his legs and stuff. But I got taken down because it wasn't related to the show.
Okay, add that to the list of all the crappy stuff I've heard about Amino.
But that's Murder of Birds. I don't, he recommended it. I don't like him. He's not my favorite RWBY YouTuber. Recently, I've been watching Vexed Viewer, Muffin Man Dan, and Fat Man Falling, but I feel like Fat Man Falling is getting kind of old. Something needs to change. Though he did release his new Volume 5 review, which was really interesting. But when he's doing the recordings for his review of each individual episode, I feel like he needs to throw in some more edits, throw in something interesting, because it's getting kind of boring. Muffin Man Dan, pretty cool guy. Some things I disagree with. He's not a fan of banter, so... Don't say any bad words to him, or he might ban you from his Discord. And then there's the Floofartist. Great guy. Definitely go subscribe to him. He's a cool little animator himself. And then there is Vexed Viewer, which... He's got great editing skills, but Lord, does he need a better mic. God, he needs better audio.
RWBY Volume 6, Chapter 3, The Lost Fable. This was it.
What? I can't hear you!
I never really thought about, like, the jokes. Because, like, I'm just listening to it for what it says and also for the visuals. But, yeah, you have a point. Batman does need to have, like, a little bit more editing done on his stuff.
I love it when he complains about Sony Vegas crashing on him. I fucking love that. Every time he complains about Sony Vegas just not working, I'm gonna be there and I'm gonna be posting a little shit post in his comments with Drake doing the I don't want Sony Vegas, and then points to Premiere Pro. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the end of the RWBY Radio Show podcast. Thank you, Lightning in My Hand, for having this interview. Thank you all for sticking around to the end, and I wish you a good day, good night, depending on what time you're watching this. Thank you.